As you have understood probably by the introduction, I am a technician. I will try not to bore you too much, but give you some technical hints that probably has to be, in my mind, taken into account also for who has the role to decide strategies and policy in this specific case about the topic of the electric vehicle charging. In this slide, I put together two typical pictures. On the left, you see a classical refueling station, gas or in diesel, what it is. And on the right side, an example of the new DC fast charge one, the one that in the previous presentation, the colleague very detailed explained to you. As you can see by the first glance looking at them, they seem similar. In the classical, there is a tube at the end moving the fuel from a big tank under the road to the car. Here you see something that sounds similar. Technically speaking, obviously, it's a cable with electricity in, but the shape, the way in which you detach the unit by the station and you connect to the vehicle sounds very similar. So the message we want to transfer is don't worry, you are not so much far from your traditional experience. It's just a matter to make pass in one case, if you will, in the other electrons, but the story is not so much different. And that could be a way to see the story. And, you know, each of us has a large experience, probably in recharging batteries by our smartphone. So charging a smartphone or a laptop is daily activity for near all of us. So it seems very simple, not far from what we need. It's not rocket science. We don't need to become super engineers to do that. But at the same time, the two processes are physically different. And that's something in my mind to be taken into account to be successful in doing it. What I want to mean? I mean that the two systems, as I said, seem similar, but when I compare more in detail them, there are differences. On the left, I put you the traditional, the fuel, and fuel is a transfer of liquid or gas. Gas fuel, in case you speak about a natural gas compressor, what it is. Meaning you move a fuel from a place to another one. It's a transfer. You pay the amount of fuel you transfer. So what you pay is what you transferred. And that's all. When we speak about electricity, it's not correct to imagine that charging is to take electrons from a place, the grid, and put the electrons in the car. That's not the case. Electricity is a loop. The electrons you put in on the positive cable comes out on the negative. So if I measure the total number of electrons coming in and out, the delta is zero. So what happens? What happens is that these electrons moving in and then out make possible that chemical reaction take place. Charge a battery means that chemical reaction take place inside. Chemical reaction means not fast as can be transfer of fuel, means an efficiency, meaning that what you pay charging the car is not one, the energy you will have to move the vehicle, is something more what you pay than what you use. And this process has a significant aging effect. In the previous presentation, there has been some remarks on the need to make wise usage of the charging to avoid a too fast decay of the performance of the battery up to the replacement. We are not so used to this problem because with mobile, with smartphone, it's common to replace them each 1-2 years because that's the trend. In cars, in vehicles, in general, not. We are not open to replace big packs of battery each 2 years, paying roughly 1/2 of the value of the car. In terms of experience, so the time I spent at the station, refueling is a very, very short experience. It's fast. In a few minutes, 1, 2, 3 minutes, you can easily, completely refuel your car. And maybe we are not so much aware, but don't forget that when you put the fuel in your car, in the pipe, in the pistol you see in the picture, is passing roughly a lot of hundred of kilowatt up to 110 megawatt. This is the power transfer we are putting in our car. One car. Clearly, you can imagine if I want ideally to do the same in my electric vehicle, if and imagine that each car under charge asks for 1 megawatt, you can immediately imagine which would be the effect on the grid infrastructure that is not sized to charge in a big cities in parallel 10,000 cars at 1 megawatt each. And so the story is different. In general, a complete recharging, the one going really to the 100%, guaranteeing the proper balancing of the cell, what previously has been already mentioned in the first presentation, in general, ask for lower power. And in general, anyway, higher power can be critical at different levels, can be, as I was saying, impacting negatively the infrastructure and also the battery. And so the experience in this case is totally different. Don't forget that today the already clear winning electric vehicle are the one like trains, underground, trolleybus, the one in which the energy exchange between the grid and the vehicle is continuous. You move the electricity to your train all the time the train is moving. And thanks to that, the power level can be lower because longer is the time, smaller can be the power to transfer the same energy. If we want to replace one-to-one the engine experience, that on the contrary is never connected to the infrastructure except at the time of charging, we need to use very, very high power. Very, very high power and battery in general, if not correctly managed, can become very risky and dangerous. Here you see two pictures, one on the left in Paris of a car sharing of Bolloré. Bolloré was one of the most famous European car sharing. You see here vehicle under charge and the effect after the fire brigade's action to extinguish the fire. And unluckily, you see on the right side an example of electric motor bicycle. To tell you what, that undoubtedly the risk, the problem are bigger with higher energy, higher power, higher voltages. Said in another word, bigger vehicle, cars, buses, trucks. You can say in smaller, two, three, four wheelers, these value are lower in general, energy on board is less, voltage is lower, risk due to the power you need two, and for some extent that's correct. In the previous presentation you have seen a guy directly swapping the battery of his moped. That's possible because the battery is small, is light, the voltage at the terminals is not dangerous, you can touch the battery without risking a shock. But at the same time, being in general, some of the problem related to the chemistry not only refer to the size, but simply to the chemistry itself, you can have big fires also with smaller vehicle. You can see on the right side, also because in general, smaller vehicle can be managed with a lot of them altogether. So some problem have to be addressed independently from the size and the typology. And the problem coming from the nature of the battery are at multiple domain. Can be electrical, we said shock, all what is over 60 volt direct current, if directly touched, can cause serious damages to the people having experience, up to the death, so very dangerous. Lower this value, not, but arcs, so the problem coming to try to interrupt the current flowing in a cable for safety or for mistakes, can be risky also with very low voltage, because this depends on the current level, not on the voltage. Chemical, and chemical again are independent from the voltage level. In some condition, over voltage, short circuit battery can emit toxic gases, and so inflated is in our body can be very dangerous. And not last, but very important, last in this list, but not least, the thermal battery, particularly lithium, has a typical runaway potential phenomena, thermal runaway, in case there are problems in managing, and this can create a domino effect on the cell closer to that, risking to reach the fire condition. If you reach a fire condition with lithium ion, put water over, it is a typical practice, you know the story of Tesla, for instance, accelerate the reaction, so make shorter the time to extinguish the energy, but cannot stop the fire. So it's something that has to be, in my opinion, but if it's very trivial, correctly addressed earlier than the problem occurs. Why is important the charging phase? Because charging phase is a phase where, except you do the charging in motion, the vehicle is not possible to be used as vehicle. When the vehicle is under charge, the vehicle is not moving. And according to what I told you before, being the efficiency of charging not 100%, there is in between a charger and a battery, it's clear that these two elements impact a lot because charging time means availability, and charging efficiency means what you pay. That, as I told you, can be, is in general, more than what you have. And depending how much bigger is this window, the less the customer is happy, and if it is a fleet manager, the his business model can be satisfied. So these are two very important elements we have not in our today experience, because charging time and refueling time for a traditional car is very short, and the efficiency is one. You pay the fuel you put in the car. There is no, let me say, leakage. Also, the way in which I connect the battery, the charger to the grid has a large impact, because in part of the usage experience, you have seen in a very useful and very interesting video you have seen in the first presentation, when you connect the small, in that case was a type one connector of the AC low power charging, the 7 kilowatt was defined, it's easy. It's a small connector, it's light, the socket and plug can match very easily. Then in the second video, you've seen what can be done with a DC charging. Higher power, that means immediately heavier device, bigger connector, and also the force to be applied to connect the connector itself to the vehicle and to remove it is not the equivalent to the other one. So this changes a lot. If you have a robotized system, obviously the experience can be smoother. If you have more enhanced solution like the wireless, the level of safety for who connect the vehicle to the grid are higher. So this is very relevant. And the electric safety is one effect of that. And not least, but not last again, but not least, the impact on the infrastructure. If I need a 7 kilowatt, my grid in general is already designed for. If I start to put everywhere 100 of kilowatt DC fast charger, I need to understand where and how to connect, if there is the proper power available, or I need to make a medium to low voltage transformation ad hoc for my needs. There are different ways depending the typology. We are today used to speak about the first case, the classical code conductive AC charging, so AC because in this cable is flowing the alternative current, and the device making the DC for the battery is on board, the charger is on board, and this is the most common way, is the way we use for the main part of experience. If you have an electric vehicle, electric car or motorbike at home, that's the typical way to charge them. Or the last one, the last one is the DC fast charger. Be aware that there's a big difference. It's called DC because here DC is flowing in the cable and going to the battery. But the big difference is that here the charger is on board, here the charger is off board. So the level of cost and complexity of this station in respect of the unit you have here to connect in a safe way this cable is totally different. In this case, charger is totally on board. In this case, charger is totally off board. Charger is here, where here is the charger in this case. Third case that is becoming a little more popular is the wireless. In the wireless, the charger is split. One part of the charger can be, for instance, in the ground, and one part under the car. If it is a bus, the opposite can be on the roof and on the infrastructure. In this case, you pass energy through the air. This acts like an insulating transformer, make the electrical safety experience superior, but being air, the conductive element for the current and the field, here possible EMC, EMI, electromagnetic issue has to be addressed. So each solution has pros and cons. As said before, you can do with a continuous connection, cables, DC or AC, or through the air. The two ways have these pros and cons, as I said you before. About charging time, the reason why the problem of the power is rising up is coming from this very simple physical equation. The physical equation tells us that the energy we want to transfer in a device is the product, except efficiency, of power by time. Meaning that if we want to have on board more and more energy, and this rush to have more and more energy on board is typical of cars, Tesla is one precursor of this theory, 100 and more kilowatt hour on board, clearly make this number bigger. Why I want this number bigger? Bigger is this number, higher is my vehicle range, so the number of kilometers I can do. If I want at the same time a shorter time to go closer and closer to the today engine experience, few minutes as our experience, again, I see this value going down. So if I rise up energy and I move down time, obviously the only way to match the needs is to increase power. And power, that's the reason why are becoming bigger and bigger. What means? Few examples. Here I put you for passenger cars, large, mid-size numbers, today numbers. This is, for instance, Tesla Model 3. This is, for instance, Tesla Model S. And here are the time. 20 for partial DC fast charge is a typical target time for today. 5 can be the dream. If I put together the shorter time, near like a car of today with gasoline, and a big energy, that's what happened. To charge this vehicle, I would need, negligent efficiencies, more than 1 megawatt. And 1 megawatt, obviously, is not something I have at my plug at home. So you can see how big can be the impact of this choice, if needed. Trying, on the other hand, to see the story from the positive perspective, if I go to compare, complete my comparison with the gasoline, there is another big difference. With my gasoline diesel car, I go to make refueling at the station, full stop. If I want to put electricity in my car, I have multiple potential options. I can do, if I have at home a charging place in my garage, if I have a garage, I can do at work if there are the infrastructure in my office, for instance. I can do in a public area, for instance, at a mall while I'm doing my shopping or when I am at the cinema to see a movie. Or I can do having it on highway, so in what today are the classical gasoline station. This multiple option opened the door to different choices and different blending. Clearly, it asks, as said before in the previous presentation, a combined action between who realize and fix the infrastructure and who want to use it. Clearly, having the plurality, if I have of the solution you see here, the problem can become, at least for some vehicle, lower, because some vehicle, classical private, at the end, particularly in urban usage, are used 5-10% of the day. So you have a lot of time to recharge them. You have the night to do it with lower power that helps also the grid to be less overloaded. Clearly, that can be true for some vehicle, not for others. If my vehicle is a professional vehicle and I want to operate it the more time that I can, 12, 14, 16 hours a day, I cannot only trust on that. I need further action. But exploit this potentiality, changing the paradigm of when I go to make the refueling, in this case recharging, in my mind is the way to do it. Clearly, the problem is how to organize this complexity. This complexity at the end moves in this direction. Electricity is a great plus in respect of fuel. You can easily, or technically easily, transfer it. You can move electricity by a solar roof to a car, you can move it to a building and so on. And creating this electric ecosystem in which cars, vehicle becomes part of the distribution and storage electricity grid of the cities could make really the difference. Improving largely the quality of the air because I avoid the pollution in town. That is a very critical point for all of us, independently from the continent in which we live. All of us has the same problem at a different level, but all of us has it. But it asks for planning. It asks for defining the right technical solution with a scenario technologically in continuous evolution. That's another critical point. To reach the goal, and speaking about charging point, where to put the charging station, clearly I have two levels. The first level is the geographical, where I physically put the station. And here, who has to plan the story has to understand and decide which is the maximum distance from one station to the closer that you want to accept. Discuss a lot, accessibility. People have to go there and make charging. Better if it will be in future robotized, today in general not. So I need to find a way to do it in a safe, easy way. The impact on the landscape. I live in Europe where there are old cities, where there are some city center area where to install a station to recharge a vehicle is not possible for impact, negative impact on the landscape. So also that is a point to be considered. Like the distance in respect of buildings. You have seen the example of fire in the case I show you, having this system closer to place where people is living can be a problem to be addressed with safety proper levels. But there is another element of the positioning to be considered. One is the physical position in the upper. The other is the connection to the grid. Because bigger is the charging station, more relevant is to understand where my cable are connected to the grid. So the local impact that the system can have on the grid. And here, to leverage this high power I need, very relevant become possible functional synergies. There are already demo projects that show, like, if I have a tramway in my cities, and the tramway in general, when regenerative braking put the energy in the grid, this energy can be used to charge the vehicle. And the vehicle parked, if bidirectional, can supply the peak during the acceleration of the tramway. So become a way in which the energy flows in two directions, trying to make the best for both. Like hybrid solution are becoming more and more popular. DC big charger with batteries, with solar panel linked together to avoid peaks of power request to the grid are a good way to distribute the energy request in time, avoiding the negative effect on the grid with possible blackout condition. And the chance to move bidirectionally the energy through the vehicle becomes a very relevant future element, meaning the battery in my car that is maybe parked at 10 hours a day will be not only something to be charged, but can be also a source of energy for transit needs. It obviously asks for a coordinated approach. The more we want to exploit this wonderful future, the more the different players has to work together. The natural way each make his business in this case doesn't give the result we would like to have. To tell you how difficult it is to reach the goal, I present to you two slides, a recent slide from the European Car Maker Association, showing which is the infrastructure situation in Europe. This is the classical Europe now without United Kingdom. You see the different country. Here is France, Germany, Italy, Spain, and the others. Here is Russia, that's your reference, and you are on obviously on the right side of the picture. If you go to see the so-called Euro 27 situation, that's what we see. Just three countries, Netherlands, France, and Germany, has the 70% of the charging public capability in all Europe. And they cover less than 25% of the ground, of the physical ground of this colored area. So you can immediately see how not correctly, in a theoretical way, and not correctly distributed is this infrastructure. That means that in this country, the blue one and maybe the green a little, you can imagine to exploit electric vehicle in massive way. In the other is a dream. We can say tomorrow we want 100% electric vehicle, but under this condition is technically impossible. And as you can see, Europe has policy to try to address the story more, we can say, homogeneously, but it's not so easy. The same is in terms of fast, not fast charging. If you consider 22 kilowatt as the border between the not fast charging, the seven single phase, the 22, 33 phase, and the 22 and up, or 50 and more, that's what you see. These are the different 27 European countries, and in all of them, at the end, there is a big imbalance between the capability to make high power charging and low power. One station on nine is giving the fast capability that the newspaper present as available for everybody. So we are very, very far from the goal, also from this perspective. And to understand how much is the power I need for DC fast charging, I need really a crystal ball. Why? Because, as you can see, the power is growing up without any control. The 50 kilowatt already mentioned in the previous presentation was few years ago a goal. I remember a study done by a company very expert in the field saying 50 kilowatt is more than enough. Now we reached 20 to 220 kilowatt. Someone is already speaking of solution for luxury car 350 kilowatt, and for trucks and so on. Germany, for instance, is deploying a grid at 1 megawatt. So you can immediately understand if you are the guys that put the money to have an infrastructure useful and applicable, how the moving from 50 kilowatt to 1 megawatt can totally change the story. Imagine I spend my money to have a very effective 50 kilowatt infrastructure in my country, then I want to use it in practice. And what I realized after a few years is that the goal was 20 times more. That means that I spend my money and I will never be back by my investment because infrastructure cannot be refurbished each 2 years. And here it's very difficult to understand which is the right solution, because everybody wants everything and the opposite. While if I speak about 2, 3, 4 wheelers, this power level are largely more than what I need. So again, which vehicle I want to address? Big buses, motorped, cars? Not so easy also that to be understood. Now there will be a long list of standards. I don't want to bore you with standards because standards are by themselves a boring topic. I want just to give you, to leave you this this slide to make you possible, if you need, to see which are the standardization activity to try to have common approaches, safe and common approaches to this topic. Here are the International Standardization Organization standard for the power transfer, both AC and DC, the one we have seen before, and wireless, included automatic conductive power transfer. This standard that is in progress in terms of preparation is the standard that can make, at least for who want to follow ISO, define the rules, the technical rules, safety rules in particular for all the typologies. You see here, for instance, for cars, for big trucks, this is conductive, this is wireless. And there are also the same for the 2, 3, 4 wheelers, in particular for the motorcycles. There are standards that are the application of that for the purpose. There are a lot of, in this case, IEC, International Electrotechnical Committee standards for the charging from the grid side, for the infrastructure side. I want to bore you with all of that, but you have the reference if you need. This is only for conductive charging, these two pages. For cars and trucks and buses, here again, also the part regarding the needs at home of that. There are standards for connectors. You have seen before the type 1 example in your first video. This one was that connector. It is typical American, China, Japanese solution. And the CHAdeMO. CHAdeMO is DC fast charge. It is another standard here not represented. On the contrary, you see the so-called CCS, the combined AC-DC we use in Europe and we use in US. This, for instance, is a safe connector to recharge 2, 3, 4 wheelers, avoiding the classical socket plug we are used to apply, like a computer that is not 100% safe. Same is for wireless. You have here also the same for wireless. And here, very important, all the chapter of the communication already mentioned in the previous presentation. Here is the big standard, the 15118 for the communication vehicle to infrastructure, this step. But be aware, unlikely to make the business winning, make the charger speak with the cars is not enough. You need also other standards. Here, two of them are mentioned, to make possible the communication between the physical charging place and the charging system operator, and the charging system operator and the e-mobility service provider, because to manage all this complexity together, that's the level we have to reach. Very new standard are this one. These are the standard dealing with the bidirectionality, the chance I mentioned you before to make the vehicle part of the grid. And these are standard, again, under preparation, trying to address this very important part in a safe and effective way, making a winning model for all the players of this long chain. Last slide, sorry, I'm a little late, but I try to be short, are devoted to the swapping. Swapping means instead of waiting the time to recharge the battery, I remove the battery depleted and I put in the vehicle the battery already charged, assuming the charging at this point can be done in parallel, not affecting the time in which the vehicle is not usable. Swapping is not new. Here is an example from 50 years ago by Mercedes. In the field of cars and big buses, there has been a lot of trial, one by very large by, for instance, Better Place, not successful. Today, who is starting to make a real large volume also for cars in automated way is NIO, China company, Chinese company. But here is another word. NIO is making everything, is making the vehicle, the battery, the infrastructure. And the Chinese environment has different rules by, for instance, the European. While, and again, the previous presentation was very effective on that, this technology can be easily applied today on smaller vehicles because this is lighter, this is smaller, this is low voltage. So you can do the replacement by your end. And in this field, the big players of motorbike, Yamaha, Suzuki, Piaggio, are making standard by themselves to define common shape and characteristic of this battery to make them swappable between different solutions. And that can become another good way to avoid to stay waiting, because the battery are charged while you are moving the vehicle and you take only the already charged battery. These are the standard for that. Last slide, if I remember correctly, don't forget, if you want to look at the future, that someone is exploring also the chance to charge the vehicle in motion, so reducing large the power, both in this view, so cabling, it becomes like a big tramway, and by the ground. This is more research-oriented, but another option is to have the coil in the road and the vehicle moving on the road, taking the electricity by the road. For who has to invest and decide which is the future of the infrastructure, this complexity has to be considered to make the wise choices. Thank you, and sorry for the 3 minutes too late presentation, maybe.